Methodist Committee on Relief, and you have found in your bulletin the special offering envelope we do once a year for disaster relief in the U.S. and around the world. You put any amount in there. If you want it to be reflected on your statement, please put your name on it, and you can put that in the offering plate with your regular offering. Also, want to mention that it's time to think about Easter flowers. Easter is coming. Hallelujah. And so you have an order form for that, and Barbara wants you to start by April 10th, but it's not too soon to do it before then. So we'll give that some thought. I want to mention that we are planning on changing our worship time starting next Sunday, starting in April. Our worship time is changing to 9:30 a.m. So we have to get up a little earlier. The reason for that is, as you know, I'm also the pastor at the Otterbein Church, and I will be, when the church is ready, doing two services on Sunday mornings, one here at 9:30 and one at 11 there, so I need a little time to get there. So anyway, the 9:30 time starting next week, we expect and hope that the Otterbein Church will be open for Easter Sunday, which is really exciting, right? Amen. So it won't be finished by any means. It'll still be a lot of work to do, but with the bathrooms finished and the entryway and the sanctuary all in order, we'll be able to worship in there. So we are really looking forward to that on Easter. And I also want to mention the Zoom Bible study continues on Tuesday evenings from 7 to 8. And our mission project, thank you so much. So many people have brought things for Ukraine, all things for collecting personal care items. And that's this month's mission project. And thank you for all who have already contributed to that. And I know it's a drop in the bucket, but to the people who need it, it's something. So we're going to do what we can. And go back to the humanitarian crisis that's happening right now. So those are all the announcements that I want to mention. And Ron is going to give us an announcement on behalf of the Staff Pastor Parish Relations Committee.
Yes, the Staff Pastor Parish Relations Committee did a Zoom meeting a week or so ago. And as we announced earlier, Pastor Catherine will be retiring in June. Her last day preaching for us will be June 12th. Bishop Scholl has appointed licensed local pastor Deborah Stevens to be our new pastor starting in July. She will be serving Evansburg United and Otterbein United Methodist. She has some experience serving two churches as she substituted for a pastor who had a dual appointment when she was away. Pastor Deborah lives in Douglasville. She is married and has two sons and three grandchildren. She ran a licensed family daycare for 31 years. She's an avid crafter. She currently owns and runs a furniture repair and refinishing business, as well as a craft business. She has gone to Redbird Mission and helped construct the worship center for inmates and their families. She also has worked with Habitat for Humanity, helped with community meals, and done volunteer work with various other nonprofit organizations. She is looking forward to worship service, Bible studies, prayer meetings, children's programs, and working with the community. Until then, we will enjoy the leadership and spiritual guidance of Pastor Pat.
Last week we used three. We'll start with
15, Awesome God.
Oh,
righteous. Delight in praise, O you upright.
Praise the Lord with the lyre. Make melody to the Lord with the harp of 10 strings.
Sing to the Lord a new song. Play skillfully on the strings with loud shouts.
Upright is the word of the Lord, whose work is done in faithfulness.
The Lord loves righteousness and justice. The earth is full of the steadfast law of the Lord.
By the word of the Lord, the heavens were made, and all their hosts by the breath of God's mouth.
The Lord gathered the waters of the sea as in a bottle, and put the deeps in storehouses.
Let all the earth fear the Lord. Let all the inhabitants of the world stand in awe.
For the Lord spoke, and it came to be. The Lord commanded, and it stood forth.
The Lord brings the counsel of nations to nothing, and frustrates the plans of the peoples.
The counsel of the Lord stands forever. The thoughts of the Lord, of God's heart to all generations.
Blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord, the people whom the Lord has chosen as their heritage.
The Lord looks down from heaven and sees all peoples.
The Lord sits enthroned and looks forth on all the inhabitants of the earth, fashioning the hearts of them all and asserting all their needs.
A king is not saved by his great army. A warrior is not delivered by his great strength.
The war horse is a vain hope for victory, and despite its great might, it cannot save.
Behold, the eye of the Lord is on those who are faithful and hope for God's steadfast love to deliver their soul from death and to keep them alive and found.
Our soul waits for the Lord, who is our help and shield.
Our heart is glad in the Lord because we trust in God's holy name.
Let your steadfast love, O Lord, be upon us, even as we hope.
But while he was still far off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion, and he story in which people expected Jesus to be judgmental of people who suffered misfortune, and he turned it around and told the more fortunate to look at themselves. Today we come to this very familiar story in Luke chapter 15, the story we call the prodigal son. Most good stories have a recognizable pattern. It begins by introducing some characters, and then there's some kind of problem that comes up, and then through the story, it gets resolved, either a happy ending or a sad ending. Before Jesus tells the story, we hear from the Gospel of Luke that some people are complaining about him, that he eats with tax collectors and sinners. He is hanging out with the wrong sort of people. And that just seems a little fishy, a little funny. And they're making this complaint. No doubt, Jesus is aware of their complaints, and probably also the people in the crowd that are coming to listen to him, that some aspersions are being cast on Jesus. So Jesus responds with this story, this parable. The characters are introduced in verse 11. There is a father who has two sons, a younger and an older son. And as we see in the story, these two sons fall into the classic roles of the burglar, of the older son and the younger son. The oldest is the responsible one, the one who served dutifully, does the right things, obeys the father. The younger is the wild one, the one who likes to socialize, likes to party, and likes to have a good time. He wants to go out and experience the world. Does anybody get the oldest child in the family? I am. Aren't those younger siblings a pain? Always. They messed up. Is anyone here a younger sibling? Oh, I guess we have siblings. Aren't those older siblings a pain? They're bossy. They always think they know what's right. They're critical. That's how that goes. As the story starts out, the problem is clearly the younger son. He has the nerve to go to his father and say, "I'd like my inheritance now, please. I can't wait." And he wants to leave the family and go somewhere else. I had a relative, she was getting older. She lived in her home by herself. And she was doing okay. People would check on her, and she had family that would come visit her. She didn't have any children, nieces and nephews. And one time, comes to himself. And he makes up a plan in his mind. I will tell my father I no longer deserve to be called his son. I'm not expecting him to treat me like a son. I'm just going to ask him if I can work to survive. He arrives dirty and starving. He doesn't even have sandals on his feet. The father sees him coming down the road from afar off. That's in verse 20. While he was still afar off, the father saw him and was filled with compassion. You know, I get the impression the father has looked down that road many times, hoping that his son will come back. Maybe one day I will see my son again. And he sees him. And he knows instantly that his son has been through a lot and that he has suffered for his mistakes. The son carries out his plan. He expresses his shame and his repentance. I no longer deserve to be your son. The father puts his arm around him and kisses him, orders a robe to be brought, some sandals, and a celebration to be prepared. And it's a wonderful ending. Father who has forgiven his son, the son who has realized his mistakes. And this could be the end of the story. Happy ending. Everything is good now. But it's not the end. There is another whole section to this story. I hope you feel good about ending it here. We all know what it's like when we've made mistakes, we've sinned, we regret something, and it's wonderful to know that God wants to forgive us. We long to be in the loving arms of God. and celebrate. The father explains his feelings. We had to rejoice because this brother of yours was dead and has come back to life. He was lost and has been found. And the brother is just at the end of the story, refusing to go in. That's where he stops the story. At the end of the story, it's now the older brother who's the problem. He is the one who won't join the family. And we don't know what they'll do. The story, that's not really the end. Will he stay out there? Will he go in? Will he change his mind? Jesus doesn't tell us. So it's a cliffhanger. And right there. What will happen? How wonderful it would be if the older brother could accept the grace of the Father and be gracious himself. How wonderful it would be if he could give up his resentment and go in and enjoy the good food and the dancing. He has his brother back. If nothing else, someone to help with the chores. You know, something that he could be rejoicing about. My long lost brother is back. And he knows he's been foolish. But the older brother, when Jesus ends the story, is still standing there. And this is the story Jesus told to the people who were complaining and judging him for spending his time with sinners. I think Jesus left the story